Dear brethren, we welcome all of you here to this place to hear God's word. And we are very thankful to the Lord for this wonderful time that he gives us to be together with representatives of our brethren around the world. I ask you, brethren, let us pray so that we can be baptized by the Holy Spirit in this moment. The Lord can open our mind, our heart to receive his words. That's my wish and prayer. Amen. Brethren, there are in the world several organizations, I would say very well directed, very well organized. But they are motivated by different reasons. For instance, the army. The army is very well organized in different countries. And there are a kind of hierarchy. Between the soldier and the general, there are different ranks. How about if one of them, they disobey the rules? What would be the consequence? I remember that once we were traveling by bus from São Paulo to Brasília. And our bus was full. All the seats were busy, occupied. And there was a soldier in the side road. He asked, he made a sign for the bus, and he would like to be in that bus to go to Brasília, because he was a soldier. He was a guard of the palace. And the driver said, look, there is no room at all. We are totally full. He said, please be merciful to me. I need to go. If I will be late there, I will be in problem. He would be arrested. Then, brethren, the army, they are a very strict discipline. What is the motive? Fear. If they don't obey, they will be punished. In other organizations, for instance, the Catholic Church, there is a big difference between the priest and the pope. There is a strong hierarchy. Then priest, bishop, archbishop, cardinal, and pope. Other religious organizations as well. They are very well organized. There are strict order, strict discipline. Some organizations, they use brainwash. They use other methods to motivate people to obey. How about in Christ's kingdom? Should we have order among us? Yes. But what should be the motive? Love. There is a big difference. We find here, brethren, I invite you to open your Bibles in Matthew chapter 20, verse 20 to 28. The evangelist says, then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, what wilt thou? She said unto him, grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on thy right hand and the other on the left in thy kingdom. We find here another thing that's very common in the world. You make a special favor for me, okay? You give a good position to my son, considering my influence. Do you know things like that in the world? Yes. In some countries, brethren, the rule is not for everyone. Some people, when they are faced with the law, they say, do you know who I am? Do you know who I am? Do you know experience like that as well? Yes. But not in the kingdom of Christ. Then Christ put some questions. He understood the desire of those children of Zebedee to be together with him in the kingdom, he understood, he realized that they really loved Christ, even though they were affected by selfishness. But Christ then, he gave a precious lesson that we are still learning today. Let us read from verse 25. Jesus called them unto him and said, "You know that the prince of the Gentiles exercises dominion over them. And they that are great exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many." Brethren, you should understand deeply this lesson here. Because this is the law of Christ's kingdom. And who is our greatest example? Christ says in verse 28, "Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many." Brethren, we recognize that Christ is the highest authority in the universe. Do you agree with that? Christ is the highest authority in the universe. But to save us, what did he do? He not only became man, he became servant. And more than that, he said, he became servant in such a way that he died on the cross to save us. Then from his highest position in the universe, he became the lowest to save us. Brethren, this is the essential lesson that I need to learn. You need to learn. Christ, being the highest, became the lowest. He being the creator, he became creature. He became servant. And he took a position of a criminal. He never committed a crime. He never committed a sin. But he took the position of a criminal because we are criminals since we are sinners. But he took our place to die for us on Calvary. We find a very interesting experience there in John chapter 13. Do you remember? Let us quote without reading to save time. Brethren, the disciples, they had a very great expectation. Political expectation. They understood that Christ was the Messiah, but they had a very wrong conclusion, understanding about the mission of the Messiah. They believed that Christ would be the emperor, political emperor. He would take control of the world with military force, and those 12 disciples, they would be his prime minister, minister of defense, minister of economy. They would occupy high position in his kingdom. And in John chapter 13, Christ came to give them a practical lesson of humility. They were expecting that since they were associated with Christ, there would be a servant there to wash their feet. But there was no one servant. And they said, "Oh, for me, it's not proper to wash feet of my fellow workers, because I will be a minister, I will be a prime minister, I expect a high position in the kingdom. Brethren, then for their great surprise, Christ took the position of a servant. He started washing everyone's feet. The disciples, they were shocked with that attitude. Christ took the position of a servant. And we find here in John chapter 13, when he finished his work, giving that practical sermon, he said, as I have done, you should do. He says, verse 13, you call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Brethren, do you remember when Judah, he had planned already to betray Christ? And Judah was the first one to have his feet washed. That was a very powerful appeal to his heart to surrender his life to Christ. But what was the effect of that work? That act of Christ should humble him to surrender his life to Christ. But Judah was so hardened that very act used by Christ to convert him was used for him to make his final decision against Christ. He understood this way: if Christ is washing my feet, he is not the Messiah. I don't believe in him anymore. I reject totally. He didn't accept that principle that Christ came not to be ministered unto, but to minister. Brother, who will be closest to the throne of God? Those who have a high position in this earth? No. Totally opposite. Christ said, to him that overcomes, will grant to sit with me my throne. Even as also overcame, and I'm set down with my Father in his throne. Brethren, what should we overcome? Brethren, I read in Step to Christ that the most offensive sins before God, you remember? First, pride, selfishness, and covetousness. Then, brethren, in a few words, which one is the most powerful enemy that we have to overcome? Self. Interesting that when the soldiers attacked Christ in the Gethsemane, Peter was ready to cut the head of the enemy. And he tried to do that. But when his self was touched, what did he do? I don't know the man. I don't know Christ. D. the one who stands nearest to Christ will be he who on earth has drunk most deeply of the spirit of his self-sacrificing love. Is clear? Who will be nearest the throne? He who on earth has drunk most deeply of the spirit of his self-sacrificing love. Love that moved the disciples, it moved our Lord to give all, to live and to labor and sacrifice even to death for the sake of humanity. This spirit was made manifest in the life of Paul. He said, "For me to live is Christ." For his life revealed Christ to men. And to die is gain. Gain to Christ. Death itself would make manifest the power of his grace and gather souls to him. Christ shall be magnified in my body, he said, whether it be by life or by death. The Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. Brother, let us put special attention here in the principle of the kingdom. Christ put a contrast between worldly kingdom and Christ's kingdom. He says, in the kingdom of the world, position meant self-aggrandizement. The people were supposed to exist for the benefit of the ruling classes. Influence, wealth, education were so many means of gaining control of the masses for the use of the leaders. The higher classes were to think, to decide, enjoy and rule. The lower were to obey and serve. Religion, like all things else, was a matter of authority. The people were expected to believe and practice as their superiors directed. The right of man as a man to think and to act for himself was wholly unrecognized. Christ was established a kingdom on different principles. He called men not to authority, but to service. The strong to bear the infirmities of the weak. Power, position, talent, education, place their possessor under the greater obligation to serve his fellows. Do you remember that? But the disciples were affected by worldly thinking. The great rule, the lower. And Christ came to reveal in his character, in his life, in his works, a totally opposite principle. Brethren, if I have more money, I should work, I should help more. If I have more knowledge, I should be more useful to help others. If you have a high position, that high position is not to serve himself, is to serve others. That's the Christian principle. Brad, there is a very interesting Bible verse, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 19, which says, though I be free from all men, yet I have made myself servant unto all. Martin Luther, he wrote a book about this Bible verse. He explains very well that by faith in Christ we are free people. By faith in Christ we are free from condemnation, we are free from men, we are free from powers, we are free from everything by faith. But by love I become servant of all. Then Paul says, though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all. Not seeking mine own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. This, brethren, is a wonderful principle. Then when we accept Christ as our Savior, we are free from condemnation, we are free from slavery of sin, we are free from eternal death. We are free men. The most deep sense of the word. When we believe in Christ, we become free. But by love, voluntarily, willingly, we become servant, to serve, to obey, to save. In matter of conscience, the soul must be left untrammeled. No one is to control another's mind, to judge for another, or to prescribe his duty. God gives to every soul freedom to think and to follow his own convictions. Every one of us will give account of himself to God. No one has a right to measure his own individuality in that of another. In all matters of principle is involved, let every man be fully persuaded on his own mind. In Christ's kingdom, there is no lordly oppression, no compulsion of manner. The angels of heaven do not come to earth to rule, to exact homage, but as messenger of mercy, to cooperate with men in uplifting humanity. Then, brethren, in Christianity, we are free to be servant. Then we become servant by choice, by our own decision, not by force, not by brainwashing, not by compulsion. We serve because we love. We love Christ, then we serve Christ and his children. Interesting that before sin, that was the law of the universe, still today. Look at this quotation. Even now, all created things declare the glory of his excellence. There is nothing save the selfish heart of man that lives unto itself. Then, brethren, when God created the universe, he created us to serve, to help each other, not to control each other. But as inspiration says, there is nothing save the selfish heart of man that lives unto itself. No bird that cleaves the air, no animal that moves upon the ground, but may feel a sense of, but minister to some other life. There is no leaf on the forest, a lowly blade of grass, but has its ministry. Brother, we should understand what means this word minister. Ministry. I remember one brother who used to enjoy saying, brethren, I'm a minister. Brethren, I'm a minister. I understand that brother, he didn't understand what the meaning of minister. Because ministers, according to the Bible, what is a minister? Servant. To minister, to serve, to help. Every tree and shrub and leaf pours forth that element of life without which neither man or animal could live. The sun sheds its light to gladden 1,000 worlds. The ocean itself, the source of all spring and fountains, receives the stream from every land, but takes to give. The angels of glory find their joy in giving, giving love and tireless watch care to souls that are fallen and unholy. Heavenly beings wood are hearts of men. They bring to this dark world light from the courts of above. By gentle and patient ministry, they move upon the human spirit to bring the lost into a fellowship with Christ, which is even closer than they themselves can know. Then, brethren, what's the purpose of our life, our Christian life? What's the purpose? To serve, to help, to save. What the condition to be close to the Christ throne? What the condition? It says to overcome. To overcome what? To overcome selfishness, pride, covetousness. Brethren, we find a wonderful quotation from Great Controversy, which says, nearest to the throne are those who were once zealous in the cause of Satan, but who, plucked as brands from the burning, have followed their Savior with deep, intense devotion. First, I mentioned the first, who be the nearest the throne. Next, are those who perfect Christian character in the midst of falsehood and infidelity. Those who own the love of God when the Christian world declares it void. And the millions of all ages who were martyred for their faith. And beyond is the great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations, kindred, and people, and tongues. Brethren, all kind of sin is offense to the Lord. But look here, a little difference. The drunkard is despised. And is told that his sin will exclude him from heaven. While pride, selfishness, and covetousness too often go unrebuked. But these are sins that are especially offensive to God. For they are contrary to the benevolence of his character, so that unselfish love, which is the very atmosphere of the fallen world. He who falls into some of the grosser sins may feel a sense of his shame and poverty and his need of the grace of Christ. But pride feels no need. You see, brother, how dangerous is pride? Pride feels no need, and so it closed the heart against Christ and the infinite blessing he came to give. But there was a very interesting experience in my school. A mother of a 9-year-old boy named Mark, she received a phone call in the middle of the afternoon. It was the teacher of the school from her son's school. And the teacher said, Miss, something unusual happened today in your son's third grade class. your son did something that surprised me so much that I thought you should know about it immediately. And the lady was concerned. What did my son do? The mother became to grow worried. The teacher continued, nothing like this had happened in all my years of teaching. This morning I was teaching a lesson of creative writing. And as I always do, I tell the story of the ant and of the grasshopper. Brad, do you know the history, the story of the ant of grasshopper? Do you know? In Portuguese, é a cigarra e a formiga. Then I used to tell the story to the children. And the teacher told the story, telling the story. The ant works hard all summer and store a splint of food. But the grasshopper plays all summer and does no work. Then winter comes. The grasshopper begins to starve because he has no food. So he begs, please, Mr. Ant, you have much food. Please let me eat too. Bread in many countries. I remember I was a little child when I heard this story. What was the answer of the ant? You didn't work in summer. Now you die. You was always singing. I was working hard. Now you should die. But the teacher stopped the story here. And the student, they should finish the story with their own creation, creativity. When the teacher stopped the story at that point, she said, then I said, boy and girls, your job is to write the ending of the story. Then she talked to his mother. Your son Mark raised his hand, said, teacher, may I draw a picture? Well, yes, Mark, if you like. You may draw a picture. But first, you must write the end of the story. But your son ends the story in a way different from any other child. He wrote, so, the ant gave all his food to the grasshopper. The grasshopper lived to the winter, and the ant died. Do you know what he put on the end of the story? What he drawn there? In the picture, at the bottom of the page, Mark had drawn 3 crosses. Dear brethren, Christ lived a perfect life. He worked hard for our salvation. He went to Gethsemane. He went to the cross. For what? So that we, sinful people, sinners, could live. And he died on the cross for me, for you. Christ gave the most precious lesson of God's character. He came not to serve, to be serviced, but to serve and to give his life for our salvation. Dear brethren, are we willing to learn the lesson? Are we willing to accept this lesson? Are we willing to accept Christ as our Savior and Lord? Are we? Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let us sing together. Hymn number 344. Live out thy life within me. 344.
Our dear Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus, our Savior, we come before Thee with thanksgiving for the gift of life, for the wonderful plan of salvation. For Christ, who being the creator became servant and gave his life on Calvary for us. We thank the Lord for the precious lesson from thy word. We thank you, Lord, for the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, giving us understanding of thy principle. You know, Lord, by nature we are proud, we are selfish. And we need your transforming grace. Take our hearts. Take control of our life. Give us grace to submit ourselves to thy control. Give us the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Help us to live according to thy will, to reflect your character, and to do thy work for the hastening of the coming of Jesus. Bless this congregation here. Bless those who are represented by this brethren here around the world. Be with thy people everywhere. And help us, Lord, to be closer to thee. Help us to look to Jesus as our Savior and our example. Help us to make a complete surrender of our life to thee. Help us to be ready for thy soon coming. And make of us instrument in thy hands to do thy work, to complete the plan of salvation by thy grace. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.